It is another edition of the Daily Grossi. Chris Holdak and our Browns analyst Tony Grossi alongside me. All right, Tone, let's dive into it. We've been talking about the idea of the Browns going to Brazil to start their season against the Philadelphia Eagles. It had been rumored earlier this week that today could be the day that the Browns hear one way or another. Do we have any latest news as it comes to the Browns season opener?
I don't have any new news to report at this time, Chris. We may not have any news, but I'll stick to my guns from the source that told me at the owners' meetings the clubs involved would find out today. Okay, they're going to be pledged to secrecy, and then they're flying out to Sao Paulo, Brazil on Monday, and there will be an announcement at some point early next week from there. It'll either be Philadelphia in Green Bay or Philadelphia in Cleveland. So I do know that preparations are all made just in case. And as soon as they get the word, the selected people will go out there. But we may not know it until next week.
So you're saying that the announcement will be some type of video with Roger Goodell and potentially a Browns representative next week. Do you know who that representative is?
I don't. I just know that both teams are poised, Green Bay and Cleveland, to head out there. Now, when the phone call comes in, either reservations will be canceled or someone will be boarding that plane on Monday.
So, Tone, I think what you do coming off of the Easter weekend, I think what you do is you head to the airport first thing Monday morning and you just stake out to see if any Browns representatives make their way to the airport. I think you just do your own detective work here.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to learn before that, but we just may not. I mean, the league wants to make a big splash.
Yeah.
Next week. And if there's anything to report, we'll be on it.
So, Tone, give me the pros for the Browns when it comes to the idea of playing in Brazil rather than some mid-season game overseas in London.
Well, this is a historic game. It's the first game on a Friday night in the NFL in 50 years. All eyes will be on this game. It's the only game played. There's the Thursday season opener in Kansas City, which is yet to be scheduled. And then the next day will be this game, and then heading into the weekend for week one game. So first of all, the Browns like the idea of being involved in a historic game. Also, they'll have a long walk up to this game. It won't be much time to plan. It's the first game of the year. So remember that there's usually 10 days from the last preseason game to the opening game of the season. So they have plenty of time logistically to prepare for this game. And thirdly, hey, it's better to play the Eagles on a neutral site than it is in Lincoln right. Financial Park. So I think all those reasons are why the Browns are enthused about potentially going to Sao Paulo to play this game.
All right, Tone, this morning on the Land on Demand, you wrote an article kind of breaking down the Browns depth chart right now. How different will that look from now until week one? Because I got to admit, reading through this, it feels like the roster for the most part is pretty set.
Yeah, I think it is. I think it's 90% set. Barring injuries, I think there's going to be very few differences. Now, as I break down these position groups, someone projected as a backup might outperform a projected starter and make his way into the starting lineup. As far as any more new players, we know they have 5 draft picks. So those are 5 players at, maximum that we'll see. I think the first player in the draft, number 54 overall, has a chance to be a significant player that would fit into whatever position group he is. But other than that, Chris, I don't see a lot of changes from now until then. Again, injuries are another factor, but if everyone is healthy, this is pretty much the team you're going to see starting training camp at the Greenbrier in late July.
Tony, that also got me thinking about the Browns draft picks, where they have 5. it feels like this could be a year where they say, you know what, let's take our first two, you know, 54, and then our pick in the third round, and then the rest of them maybe trade away, move back, and just try to stock up for next year. I mean, that's kind of the vibe I got reading your article. Am I way off there, or could you see a situation like that?
I could. I mean, Andrew Berry always likes to roll a couple picks into next year. First of all, people have to understand there's approximately 265 players who are drafted. Most teams, almost every team, has draftable grades on only 100 players. Okay, so once you get out of the top 100 on everybody's draft board, you're just throwing darts. I know there have been some great bullseyes over the years from various teams, you know, Tom Brady, number 199. Yeah. I guarantee you in that draft, there were about 100 players on the New England's draft board. And he happened to be one of them. Brady might not have been draftable by other teams. Mm-hmm. So the point is, after what you say makes a lot of sense. I don't know if we'll see Andrew discard his last three picks. But I don't think he goes into this draft with high expectations based on things he said at the combine, at the owners' meeting. So I think that 54th pick can be a player significance, but and maybe this third round pick.
Yeah.
But after that, it's just, you know, they've already, if you notice in the 11 players they've added new players in free agency, which I list in here in boldface in this story. Many of them are backup players. Mm-hmm. So they've already got even backup positions filled. You'd rather have a veteran backing up sometimes than a young guy who you don't know where you're going to get out of in the fifth or sixth round.
Looking at the names on paper, Tone, which is the strongest position group for the Browns?
I still think it's offensive line, not only the starting five when healthy. That's where a lot of money is invested. But also, they've done a good job with their backups, too. My question on this position group is the coaching change. And we'll see what Andy Dickerson can provide, you know, to compensate for the loss of Bill Callahan. After that, if you notice, there's a lot of numbers at defensive line. I think they have 15 players already signed and ready to go. Only eight will probably make the team, maybe nine, the 53. So, they stocked up with bodies there, and I think their front seven or eight are pretty good.
Yeah. What about the weakest position group on paper?
Well, I think right now it's evident that linebacker is not a position of high priority, and yet they've developed JOK, Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah, into a real solid playmaking linebacker. They added Jordan Hicks to that. So I think they feel good about two of their linebackers. Those are the two you'll most see on the field, barring injuries. But really, the rest of the depth there is questionable, and the rest of the depth comprises special teams core positions. So linebacker in this defense is never going to be a high priority, but at least they got one pretty solid playmaker there.
So this one, I think, could be open for a little interpretation, but which position group has the widest variance, could have the highest ceiling, but also could have the lowest floor?
Oh, wow. Okay. I think tight end right now. I mean, it's a small position group, only four tight ends on hand. But when you get after David Njoku, there's a pretty good drop off, even to Jordan Akins, number two. Mm-hmm. Right now, Giovanni Ricci is the third tight end, and that's a under radar acquisition in free agency, kind of a blocker. I think the tight end position as a whole is going to be minimized this year, except for Njoku.
Which player has the chance to be the best addition this season to the roster?
Well, I think that comes down to two players primarily, Jerry Jeudy and Quentin Jefferson, the defensive tackle. And I'm going to say Jerry Jeudy right now, I would answer. Because he's a young player, and he's had four so-so years in Denver, but it's been a dysfunctional offensive situation there. And I'm going to trust the Browns judgment on this until I see otherwise. I haven't seen a lot of Jerry Jeudy. I cover the Browns. So I just know his numbers are not great, but he's still a young player, and they could get a real impetus to their offense if he comes through for them. So I would choose him.
So Tone, the Browns today, again, if you're interested in checking out the full breakdown, go to the Land on Demand. That'll have all the different players in each position group listed as of right now. The Browns did release some dates for their offseason and the media schedule and things like that. So we will hear from Kevin Stefanski and some players mid-April. This was April 16th, some off-season workouts. What exactly does that look like from nothing on the field yet, correct?
No. So the Browns off-season program really kicks off on April 15th. Per rules of the NFL, they have to schedule one player availability in each week of the off-season program. So the Browns will have it April 16th, the second day of off-season conditioning. Remember, there are three phases to the off-season conditioning program. It starts with 2 weeks of just conditioning, weight room, and exercises unseen to the media, unopened to the media. Then I think the next 3 weeks, phase two, involves players going in position groups on the field. So it's just running backs, you know, the running back coach going through drills, introducing their drills. Every position group that goes on for 3 weeks. And then after that is what we call OTAs, organized team activities on the field. They're basically glorified practices, no pads. That goes on for 3 weeks. And that takes you right into the end of mandatory mini camp in June. Okay. So each week of these phases, there will be one media availability. Well, we'll hear from coaches, we'll hear from players, and the same stuff we've seen over the years. So it'll be interesting this year. You know, the first time the media goes on the field, will Deshaun Watson be throwing completely? You know, that's what we're going to be you know, focusing on in the offseason, right? The development of or the progress of Watson and seeing Winston in a Browns uniform for the first time, things like that.
Yeah. So Tony, it's crazy that, you know, come Monday, next time you and I talk, it'll be April, which means it's draft month. And before you know it, training camp, and you'll be at the Greenbrier once again. We'll see if that's the case.
Of course. Then there's the annual pre-draft Andrew Berry press conference, which will happen before the draft, which is what, April 25th, 26th, 27th, I think. Correct. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, from Detroit. Browns will be sitting out the first round again. Hopefully they'll make a pick in the second round and not trade it away.
Let's hope so. Tone, really good stuff. We'll be on a lookout for any Brazil news potentially now until Monday, but who knows, maybe by Monday we'll have an idea if the Browns are actually in Brazil. But great stuff. Enjoy the Easter holiday. We'll talk to you on Monday.
All right, Chris. Will do. Thank you.